usually start out with a little bit of liquid white, as you know, on most of my paintings, and today will be no exception. I'll get started with some liquid white here, not too much. I just want to put a little bit here in the background. I want to get a nice soft sky up here. I have gray gesso on this canvas already, which you probably realize. And let's see, but down here is the sky. The sky comes down about right in here somewhere. Well, these mountains. Okay. That's enough for the liquid white. I think I'll put my palette on here now. I'm just going to show you my palette and explain the colors just one time. I usually do this, same colors I've had every time I paint, but here's a Bob Ross colors: titanium white, phthalo blue, Prussian blue, midnight black, Van Dyke brown, dark sienna, alizarin crimson, sap green, cadmium yellow, Indian yellow, yellow ochre, bright red, and I have a little Grumbacher ultramarine violet over here. So that's the palette as usual, and I will now put it in a position where it's out of the way while I'm painting, and hopefully I will remember to move that when I get a chance here. I'm going to put a little piece of tape on my canvas so that I know where that palette cover is. Because I'm doing this live, and it's different than trying to edit it after the fact. So I want to try to keep track of where it is. So the sky in this photograph was really just sort of grayish, grayish sky, but I'm going to make it sort of a bluish violet sky. Using the same brush excuse me, that I had and start up here, a little bit more of this violet in it. I want to make sure this is going to have a little bit of color in it that makes those mountains show up. We have snow on those mountains. This photograph was in the fall, I believe. I'm sorry, excuse me. And we were on a nice little picnic up to this lake, Kentler Lake. And if you're ever in Montana, on Glacier National Park, go to the west side and you have to drive probably 35 to 40 miles on a gravel road to get to an old town called Pole Bridge. It's not really a town, it's basically just a general store. And you go in there and you can get some nice goodies to eat and snack on, and it's about the only place around. And take yourself some nice stuff into the park. The western entrance to the park is right near there, within a couple miles of that general store. And when you go in, that's one of the first things you see is a couple of signs. One says Bowman Lake and one says Kintla Lake. And so we take the road to Kintla Lake and take our picnic and go down there and sit by the lake and have a nice picnic, and with the mountains off in the distance. Very beautiful sight, very fun thing to do. I'm mixing a little blue and a little of ultramarine here. And I want to make sure I have this tone, this lavender tone down close to top of the mountains. A little bit of alizarin in there, sort of red it up just slightly. Helps with atmospheric perspective. You've heard me talk about that before, maybe. Okay. All right. Well, I got this brush going. I'm going to pick up a little white and see if I can pop in a few things that look like some clouds here, maybe. Just nice little fluffy clouds. Make little swirling motions. I'm going to have some sun in this cloud, this painting, and it's coming from the right. So it's going to hit these trees on this side, have a nice sort of yellow band of trees that sort of point you to the cabin. And so I don't want to make it like a dark and gloomy winter sky, which is kind of what it's starting to look like in this photograph. And so I'm going to pick up a little dark midnight black, put a few little dark shadows under these clouds, give them some fluffiness, make this sky kind of interesting. Not a whole lot going on in this sky in the photograph, so I'm trying to help make it look a little more interesting. And something like this. I'm using some artistic license here, sort of making the sky look the way I want it to look instead of the way the photograph made it look. Okay. Take a little step back and look at it, see if it, you notice some changes in there, hopefully. All right. Now, these mountains, I'm going to start with a flat brush. I was using a Treckle 16 filbert here. That's what I use for the sky. I'm picking up a Treckle number 12 flat, and I'm going to start doing a little work on these mountains. Maybe the brush may be a little bit too big, but see what happens here. Just put in some interesting shapes. These mountains are off in the distance pretty far, so we don't need a lot of, they're not going to be too big, actually. That's the thing. I could make them a lot bigger, but I want to make this have scale. And the way you do that is to make mountains really small. So I'm just painting the snow on top of them. They're almost totally snow covered in this photograph. That's some greater paint over there. I'm just putting some bands of snow in here that we will paint around. Okay, let's see if I can add just a little bit of depth in there by picking up a little bit of this violet and midnight black. And we'll start putting in a few shadows. Something like that. Change the color. We'll keep it all. So the sun's coming from the left side, so, or the right side, so be coming in this way, so anything that I want to highlight, I want to have light on the right and shadow on the left, so I can put some dark shadows in here like this, and then come back and maybe connect a few more, put a few more of the, put a few more whites in there to make it show the snow. Bring in some blue. Prussian blue. Okay, take a second, step back, look at it. Look, I want. Okay, another little brush. I've got another small flat. This is like a number four. I'm going to come in and see if I can put in some small snow bands in here. Don't want to put a lot of detail in there. I'm probably putting too much in there already, because I don't want it to be too obvious. Don't want your eye to go up there, basically, is what I'm saying, when you try to figure out where to put shadows and some details. So I want to make sure that when you're off in a distance like this, that you don't have too much detail that takes the eye, and you want people to, the eye to go up there and roam around a little bit, but you don't want it to stay up in that area. Put some more sky in here. I'm using a number four. I usually don't use these smaller brushes, but for some reason I felt like I needed it on this particular painting. Okay, nice colors in there, mixture. All right. I think that might be enough for the sky and mountains. I could always come back and put a little more in there if I want. See an area that might use just a little bit more. White snow here. Some area up here. I want it to look like the sun's coming from the right side, so I want that to be lighter up there. Put it off the canvas. And a few spots in here will be highlighted. Okay. Stop, stop, stop. All right. So this area in here, this whole sort of triangular area, there's a lot of trees. They're pretty far off. They're a little hard to see. They're kind of fuzzy looking. So we're gonna paint in a number of colors. It's just one bland color actually on our photograph, but we're gonna try to mix it up, mix some different colors in there. And I think I'm gonna get my smaller filbert here, this number 10 treacle filbert, number 10. And we'll start with some greens, take some sap green, a little bit of Prussian blue with it. I want this to have a bluish cast, even though there's green in it. But the distance away should give it some sort of bluish cast. Let's see what we can do here. In this area, we're just making some interesting pretty far away, they're very small, hard to see, hard to distinguish. A lot of them got some brown in them, got some green in them. So mixing up the colors, putting in some even some ochre, we'll pull some ochre in here. And change the color. Try to keep it from looking like a straight line, even though photograph optically this thing is a straight line. It just looks like a flat line is sort of brownish. Trees back there. All the way over. It is fall, and some of these trees are, there's some aspens sitting around out here and some other trees. So I'm going to put another layer in front that sort of lightens it up. So you see a dark layer behind it. You see a little bit lighter layer here, mostly with ochre. And right here. More sap green, more Prussian blue. I'm not washing out my brush. I'm just sort of mixing colors on the brush, on the canvas, trying to get a nice, pleasing set of trees out here in the distance. Very small, very minuscule, so far away. So just take our time going across here, picking up browns, reds. Ooh, that's too much dark sienna. But it will help. Over here, I got some trees in between. Blue. Back to some ochre, fill up some other colors, too much. I'm not trying to paint a tree. I'm trying to paint a block of color that makes it look like trees. Up a little bit, maybe get some other colors in here, and then some white, maybe to make it a little lighter. Make sure I've got this. There, let's see, they're coming over this way. Opens. Tree there, let's see, here comes down here. I'm doing what I do in watercolor painting, I'm doing negative painting kind of around these trees. Most of the time oil painters don't do that, they just paint in and come back and lay something over it. And, that'll work, but kind of, so I use a sketch to work from, I kind of want to see my, where I've got, where I've left room for trees and that sort of thing, big trees in the foreground. I'm just letting the canvas sort of pull off whatever it will here. Pushing up, put dark in front of light, you get more depth. See that? Light in front of dark, you get more depth. Makes it look like layer after layer after layer of trees. So when I paint something in front like that, you can't see it, you can't tell the difference, you gotta make it darker. What's behind it is almost the same value, so it's kind of sort of studying values to look at how the a line of trees like that look. You got to keep changing them, tweaking them. So I can get some oranges in here and put in this band of lighter trees where the sun is sort of hitting the number of trees in the background here. Okay, that's quite a few trees. Now, let's take some of this green dark color on my brush by just not washing it, I'm just wiping it out on paper towel instead of cleaning it out thinner, I'm wiping it out. I'm gonna come back and pick up some ochre and some of this bright red, maybe a little Indian yellow. Indian yellow is a very transparent, beautiful color. Let's see what happens when we come in here with some of these. Whole line of bright colors in here, maybe even some cad. That's some of the colors you start seeing in the fall. They have this cad yellow to them. Throw a few of those colors up into the what's already on the canvas. Just got different colors on this brush. I just sort of rotate it. I get some cad on one side and some orange on the other. I'm letting it really light up this area. I haven't painted one specific explicit tree. I have painted a lot of shapes and objects that look like a group of trees back there. So this is the kind of feeling that we see when we go out to this area of Montana. This time of the year, there's a lot of changes going on, a lot of bright colors popping their heads up. Put some yellows in there, a few more bright colors, some other in here. And it'll start maybe darkening it down just a little. Back, get some of my darker colors, my blues, and my so this is taking quite a while, but this is a very interesting part of this painting. If you have any questions, folks, feel free to put them in the Rose Therapy. I see you there. Thanks for joining. Hope you can hear me okay. I had a heck of a time getting my sound going this afternoon for some reason. I don't know what was going on. I think I make a note to myself to do a little better testing next time before we have class. I don't know what happened. Anytime you do something live, it's always a little bit scary, a little bit frustrating. I think the technology works every time. And all of a sudden, something's going haywire. Okay, tons of trees back here. Some darks in there. If you look at this closely, and I'll zoom in after we get finished and let you take a look at this up close, but just basically changing dark colors, lighter colors, changing the value, changing the color, just to make a nice looking area of all these trees out here that are changing. They're starting to show some of their fall colors. They're starting to turn yellow, orange. In this area of Montana, that's really see a lot of that this time of year when this photo was taken. Okay, now, so down in here, this whole band, this rectangular band, has a whole set of trees that are much closer, so they're going to have some more details in them. They're going to be a little bit more detailed and defined than what I've got here in the background, or this is almost middle ground, I guess. We'll pop in just a few more little dark things here. There are some areas where it looks like I don't have enough dark, mix it up, try to make it like there's some other trees going on back there. This is a nice little filbert brush I have here. Okay, so that looks pretty good for that. Yeah, Scarpy, I see it's a nice day in Ohio. It's a nice day here in Florida where I am. It's been very nice lately. We've had 3-4 days. The temperature gets up to 81, 82, 60 degrees at night. That's not too bad in this part of the country. This time of the year is a lot of people's favorite time of the year. Okay, now let's see. We're going to start now with some more specific trees. There's a few that are still sticking up in here that are back behind these other trees. I'm going to start getting a little bit of a This area is just filled with one set of trees after these are like deciduous trees that are sort of just blooming out. So I'm mixing up my yellows, maybe even a little orange in some spots. We'll put in some trees that are closer, have more detail, have more, a little bit darker darks, lighter lights. Picking up some of this violet and putting it here. Blues. Okay. Change the color, pick up some highlights, come back and put in some. Highlight colors. This cad yellow just makes paintings pop when you put it out here like this. Dark here. Blues. Still doing some negative painting here around some other trees that I'm going to have in this area. Two more dark. Does it sort of connect things in the distant middle ground to this more foreground section of trees like that? You have a lot of green in your paintings and in the photograph. It's really hard. Green can become such a monotone if you don't change it up, add some reds, add some other colors, you end up with a green monotone. It's very, very boring. That's the problem with painting in nature. If you paint what you see, I think I'm starting to get close to my palette camera here. Let's switch that up over there. Yeah, I'm starting to get into it. Okay, so I'll move my tape reference to let you know that I have my palette camera up there. I start painting up there. I'll have to make sure I don't overlay it or paint under it. Actually, what happens when I'm doing this live, I start painting and I start painting in this area right here. You can't see it because I have my palette camera overlaid over the live feed, so it makes it a little tougher to can't see what I'm doing for sure, but I have to try to remember to move my palette cam where I have it overlaying the video feed. I have to pull my left brain out every once in a while and go back and say, where am I? What am I doing? Okay, a lot of interesting trees, tree shapes. Some darks in here, so a few more in there. It could be very boring here if I just keep putting all the same color in over there. So I'm going to keep changing it up, adding my yellows, adding my ochres. Try to get some tree definitions out of this that look like they're closer than what's behind it. The way we do that is by giving them some, try to get more three-dimensional shapes out of them here in the foreground. See how that's looking. I'm gonna step back. I'm just gonna step back and evaluate. Get so close to it that it's hard to see what's going on for, because you are so close. In here, I've got a lot of darks. Let's just get this covered here with some fairly dark paint. Okay. Some roundedness in these trees now, so it gives them some, try to get some three-dimensional shape out of them. A light value, a mid value, and a dark value. If I can do that, I can get that working, it will help tell you that's something three-dimensional. But it's not always easy to do. More darks over here. Okay, now start picking up some brighter colors. I didn't get the green out of my brush. I think I'll wash it out a little bit here and get some of the color out of them. Put in the trees before I put in any tree trunks. Pick up some white and some green. There's a some lighter color trees over here. People like that color. Let's put some blue in there to get that. Add a few more yellows in it. Okay, so I've got, instead of a big old plain rectangle with one color in it, I've got a lot of different colors, a lot of different values, a lot of different tree shapes in there. See some more I should put in that are just sort of, okay, these are already going up there. I'm just going to connect to them there, see if I can anyway. Prussian blue. I haven't used any phthalo blue today, but sometimes I don't use all these colors. That's okay. All right, now we'll put in some tree trunks. Let's get our script liner here and let's put in some. Get this thing really thin and pick up some black in it here. A little white to give myself a little bit of a. I'm gonna have some white trunks in here, trunks that are lighter, sort of light gray, so they stand out from what's behind them. And to do that, you need a lot of paint on your brush, where it's really thin, brush to a point, and see if we can put in a few. Let's see, there's a tree that's sort of like right in here that didn't have anything on it, actually. Bear. This. Some of these other trunks are going to have a little more color in them, but so I'll make them sort of gray or brownish gray. Okay, we could even scrape in a couple of things back here that look like we got some other. Just using the back of that to scrape out the paint. Find a dark area, scrape it out. Get some more paint thinner. So by making a lot of small little vertical paint strokes in here, I actually have it looking like there's a lot of stuff going on. I've got several more trees here and some big ones right here that I'm going to work on. This tree here is going to have its trunk sort of go like that. We'll put his trunk in now. We'll come back and paint around him here. That this guy's got a fat trunk right here. This guy's got a fat trunk. Mix it up, put some darks in there. You actually could, when they get a little bigger, you can actually put a little bit of a dark value on the left side to sort of indicate where the sun's coming from. So I'll be doing that on the top here, the coloring of the trees. All right, let's stop and take a look at that. Step back. See how we're doing. Okay. Have a very nice start here. Painting about half done, actually, I think. Just putting in some more vertical trunk lines. I think it looks like there's a lot going on back here. Got a tree there, three, four or five trees. This is all background there. I could have, okay, let me go back and fix that up a little bit. This area has a tree there, and this tree, there's this area, all of this area in here is all sort of background trees. So let's go put some more of that stuff in there, back in here. They're hard, they're pretty far back, can't see them very well. But they make a nice dark background to the trees in the foreground and to this little cabin here. nice other dark here. So you see what I'm doing, I'm outlining this cabin. Okay. Not this other side. I think I know how I got this. I'm gonna do this other side of this cabin here. There's another tree back here, but I'm gonna try to outline this side of the cabin. I'm hoping you're seeing that without being under the palette camera. That will help with the outline. I'm actually moving some trees in the back of this. There's a bunch of trees in front of this cabin, and I just sort of moved those and put them in the back and use my artistic license to move things around so that I could see this cabin a little better. But it was worth looking at the cabin. Okay, so we got this going on. This is going on back here, nondescript stuff. Okay, now several things I painted around again. This big brush cleaned out. Hope you're all still with me. Can you hear me okay, folks? Somebody said the sound cut out for a minute. I don't know what's going on with my sound today. Put a new battery in my microphone and rechecked all the connections, double checked, triple checked, and it's still acting funny. All right, I'm going to get some ochre, some Indian yellow, and some cad yellow, and we're going to start putting in this big tree I'm getting under my palette cam. Therefore, let me pop it over. Over there. Okay, pretty well done painting over here, so I will put my notice over there. All right, now we have a big tree. It's got a lot of green and yellow kind of stuff going on in here. Pick up some greens, pick up blue. Russian blue. Just mix it up, blues, greens. Okay. On the top of this cabin, right here, pull it up into that tree. Okay. Make it look like it's kind of all kind of connected with a series of number of trees in there. Put a few more out here like this. It's sort of, it looked like a whole bunch of stuff behind this cabin. Don't really think there was, but that's okay. Now, I don't want this to be an oval. I don't want it to be a square. I don't want it to be a circle. I want it to have abstract shape. We've talked about abstract shapes before. They're more pleasing and they're not as boring. When you're trying to pull a scene like this down from, you know, that thing's probably 30 miles to those mountains, and it's probably 2-3 football fields in width up close. That makes a lot of difference when you're trying to get it down to something that's 11 inches by 14 inches. So you have to try to make all of these things interesting and try to make them so they're not geometric shapes. Okay, take a break, step back, check it out. Feel like I have just a little bit too much yellow up in here. I think I'm gonna put just a little, break it up a little bit. And I can come back and put some tree limbs in there if I want. This area here has got another big bright tree sitting right there. Put some red in him. I get some yellow. Back to the greens and blues for the left side to make it look like it's got some three-dimensionality. Tree starting to look a little bit circular. Okay, I think I'm gonna pop that red back in here somewhere. Just to echo it so I don't have it in one spot only. Got a little bit over here, maybe that's a little bit too much. So this area where I want you to look in this area can be, have as much detail, bright colors. That's where you want to put your reds. If you're going to put red in a painting, put it in the close to the focal point and get people to look at it. Now I'm getting almost value on top of value, so I've got to do something here. I can't have the same value below than I have on top, or behind, actually behind it in front. Okay, so let's change that up a little bit, throw in some other colors here. Okay, there we go. Get some darks in here, maybe. Like here, something like that. So I'm sort of helping to paint around these trees with some dark background colors. Much of this painting has been done with just the filbert with just tapping it and letting paint come off. Whatever comes off, come off. So, a lot of Prussian blue in here to make these dark, dark areas darker. Okay. All right, I think that's looking much more like what I want it to look like. I'm gonna paint this big fir tree in here, or pine tree, whatever it is. Picking up some of my violet color, my alizarin crimson, satin green, and I'll go get some more of this blue. I want this to be fairly dark on this left side, so we'll see how this thing comes across here. Ochre in there. Really dark. Actually, a couple of trees in there. Okay, have maybe put in a little scrapes in for tree trunks here and there. Don't do too much of that, it looks too contrived or too busy if you do too much, but this dark, finish this off here. Leave room for my cabin in there. All right. Maybe I'll put just a, don't want to leave that one pine tree standing there by himself. You ever watch Bob Ross? He always puts in a couple of trees. He doesn't like to leave one standing alone. Got to get it dark enough, or it's not going to work. A lot of dark. This one. It's not dark enough. All right. Stop with that. Few more trunks. I'm going to come in as well. I got this thin brush here. I'm going to pick up a few. I'm going to put in some tree trunks here that are sort of help define something holding up all this tree in here. I see a clone. You know what a clone is? Those little humps right there. Don't like them. Eliminate clones. So I'll just use my finger and just gonna do this. Okay, so I got a few little tree trunks and things sitting in here that help make you believe there's something holding all this together back there.
fat tree trunk there. Okay, stop, stop, stop. Now, had it in the background. Not the background, but this area underneath, a bright strip of grass back there. It looks like it's sort of wheat. Question is, what color am I going to use for that? And what brush? I'm going to get a little brush because I think I want to pick up some white here and see what happens when I add a little wheat color here. Cad yellow, cad white, or titanium white, yellow ochre. This area back here. Oh, in this cabin, it's got a thin band of bright a big blob of paint on there that I don't need. It's getting just a little more orange as it comes forward. This area here is more orange in it. A whole bunch of fence posts out there that I could probably put in. Don't forget. Painted right over them. I'll probably come back and have to restate this tree. A lot of fall looking color here. Turning a little redder as it comes forward. All around this cabin, it's sort of a orange, reddish orange color. I thought about this painting, whether I want to make this. This is really just a farm field across here. It's got really nothing going on. It's just, after it's been mowed or cut, trimmed, baled, hay, I'm not sure what all went on there, but I may put a little fishing pond right here just to get some reflectivity out of this thing. I think that would be a cool thing to do. So, keep doing this. I'll get this thing in. Step back and look at it, see if it has a nice fall look to it. It does. It's a very small brush here. Make sure it has some nice. Back here. that to be lighter back there. Everybody still with me here? Somebody says this keeps getting drawn to the white tree in the middle. I assume that is this tree here, maybe? I don't know. I can thin that down so it's not quite as obvious, but I'm gonna wait, hold off on that just a little bit. Come back here and put a little bit of a roof on this cabin. Very similar colors here, but it's got probably more ochre in it. This is more of a little mixture of color in here on purpose. More here under the eave on the left side. I'm gonna make it just a little darker. Can. A bit of okay. Here we have this is truly a log cabin, or at least it looked like a log cabin. It's got the little things on the edges here that sort of stick out where the logs sort of overlap. This is a little darker here. Oh. Shadow color. Ooh. Maybe too much. Now I want it to be dark because this corner of this cabin, if the sun is coming from the right, this corner where the cabin meets like this, this corner is called the color you put on it, the shadow, if you will. It's called a plane change accent. Means the plane of the building is changing from this to this, and the side that's out of the sun at that intersection is called the plane change. So you have to accent it like this. And you can make a graded shadow out of it, but it has to be darkest right at that corner. And then you come back and put the other face on, the other plane, just here. I want a little bit of a shadow under this because it's got to be darker because of a little bit of the sun. It does cast a little shadow there. Under that, wipes the paint out, come down and start putting in the window there, a couple windows in the back, and a couple doors. But we'll just pop it in here like this. Make these little, really hard for you to see, I know. It's hard to tell what I'm doing. I'm making these little things stick out like the logs would be overlapping each other, and they stick out.
Okay. So that's the rough cabin. See if I can put in now. A little window right here. Put in a couple more windows over here like this. Like that. Using my lavender, violet, I should say, violet. This little door here, there's almost a double wide door there. And the bottom of this thing is sort of gray, there's a gray foundation underneath it. So we're just gonna pop that in. Okay. How's that look? And there is a post. So sort of sitting right here. And there's a couple of steps that actually go down here. Don't have to make that very obvious, but you can make it look like steps. Make it look like steps. Then we had a whole bunch of little posts in here. Try to make them a little bit crooked in some areas. Don't make them all perfect. Over here we had a couple that were sort of holding up a gate, actually. So, gate back here. Something like that. I'm not making these perfect. I'm letting your eye fill in. Shadow here, making this add just a little bit of a shadow on the side that's away from the sun. It's a bit too dark right there, I think. Lighten up a little bit. Okay, so that kind of gives you the impression that there's a bunch of fence posts out here. I'm going to put a few more in. Spread them out here as they go back in the distance. A little smaller, maybe a little further away. Just sort of kind of go off the canvas out there. Okay, now some of these have definite posts on them. Definite bars, rather, cross posts, cross beams. I'm not hitting every one, I'm just sort of leaving it to your imagination to fill that in. Nothing looks more amateurish than painting every perfect post and beam on a fence. Left or right. Okay, now, so I said I was still leaving this as a just a farm field out here.
I'm going to put myself in a little bit of a lake, a little fishing lake in here, I think. Get some water in here and make it look like a little fishing pond there that somebody might want to use. So let's get a little more liquid white. Maybe I'll take a second and draw something in. It's my white pencil that I would draw. If I draw this sketch freehand, this is a charcoal white pencil that makes this white ink on here. Not white ink, but it's white chalk. This is actually from a transfer sheet. But so if I had a little fishing pond back here that might just look something like this, make it sort of pull off something like that. That'll give us a chance to reflect these trees. I want to make it perfectly round, but I want to make it perfectly oval. I can put some grasses in front, put some grass over here, and we'll make a nice little pond. We can reflect the mountains in it and see how that works. So I'm making another artistic change using my artistic license. Liquid white. I'm using liquid white because I want this paint to flow very easily, and I want it to blend and make nice reflections in here. Okay, that'll be a nice area that we can have a little fishing pond, hopefully. And I get this thing going here with, we talked about what color is water. Water doesn't have a color. It only reflects what is above it or beneath it or around it. So let's see if we can get a little bit of this sky color that we had maybe in that brush. Start putting in some. Just a little bit of green to it. Okay, and now how are we going to make that look like water? We make it look like water by showing reflections in it, vertical reflections. So we go back and get the colors that are above it and pull some of those colors down. Some greens. Pull it down. Looks a little bit like the mountains back there. Maybe pick up a little white and see if we can get a some white on my brush. Okay, so all right. something like that. Doesn't have to be perfect, but it does have to be a little bit representative. Then we can take our big old flat brush, not flat brush, but the landscape brush that Bob Ross has. And the way we make that look even more like water, the vertical brush strokes make it look like water for one, but this technique of just skimming your brush very lightly across it like this, wiping the brush out, taking another stroke across like that, wipe it out, another stroke, wipe it like that. Okay, so now we have very readily a thing that looks like a little pond out there. I think that's better than just a whole bunch of grass and stuff that looks like it's left over from the last mowing of the lawn. So we're very close to completing this, folks. I'm not taking a break today. I'm just going to keep going on you and finish this thing a little early, maybe, and let you go. A little bit of a color in here that sort of looks like it might be grassy. I'll try to outline this a little bit so that it stands out. More colors of my yellows and ochres and greens. Okay, more similar colors in here. Pick up a few darks maybe in this corner over here. Around my little screw holder here. What area up here I want to forget. I haven't done yet is put a little bank on this thing. I'm gonna put a little bank backside there so that it does look even more like water. I'm gonna use for that flat brush here. Okay, well, come back. We'll get a little bit of this brown and we'll help identify this back side of this. Okay. A little bit of dark pull down here, make it sort of blend. Yeah.
Okay, that even helps tell the story just a little more even now. And in here and put in some trees in the foreground. I need a brush, so let me do that. Let's see here. I know what brush I need for this. I need my fan brush. I'm gonna put a little more. Put in a little more here with this. I got this fan brush out and sort of finishing up some of these areas here. The bottom of those fence posts need to be anchored, but what goes in the ground here is some. I'm going to put in some bushes and some. Not bushes, but just some grass by just putting in a few things like that. Putting in some of this is turning, starting to turn as well. So it's going to have some okras in it. A few more darks in here, pull up some lavender, violet color. Okay, something like that will help tell the story a bit better. Okay, got a place here that needs to have a trunk on this big tree sitting here. Finish off. And you don't want to leave it sit like that. If you can see that, you want to blend it into the ground here. Something like that. Okay, a little darker here, maybe, I don't know. Spots, maybe like a few streaks look like the logs in the cabin here. Maybe a streak or two in the roof up here as well. You also could put a chimney on this thing. I didn't put a chimney on it. Maybe. Something like that. And the forgotten would be the little highlight on that chimney. You might take some white or something and just give yourself a little bit of a like that. Could be a little brighter, maybe. That, a few little things in the windows here to help them look like they're real windows. It's too heavy-handed. Well, hopefully this is going to finish off pretty nicely for you. And if you get a chance to paint it, or if you're painting along, I hope you're enjoying it. Because I'm just about finished. Put in a few more darks back here to help things stand out a little bit better back here, maybe. There is a lot of dense foliage back here. And I sort of blurred it up a little bit when I went over it two or three times, so I want to get a little better
is for 4 flat, which is really good for this because it's just about the right size of what I need back here. Okay, folks, I think I'm going to call that finished. I have one more trunk I want to bring down here, like right in there. Break that line up a little bit. There's a big old tree sitting there. And maybe another trunk or two here. That trunk is kind of tied, but let's see here. Maybe I can cut him off to pass here, but blend it in. Okay, I'm going to make it worse if I keep messing with it. All right, one thing I have left to do is, one of the things I always do is put my block signature on here. Make it in dark sienna. And we'll just pop it right in here. Okay, I think that is going to be it for class. I want to thank you all for watching and tuning in. I will be editing this and putting it out on YouTube probably in the next couple of days. And so you'll be able to watch it again. And let me zoom. I promised I would zoom in. Let's take this in the deal here and see if I can zoom in. I'll move it to the top and we'll start at the top. Okay, now let's move this way. You see the mountains have a little bit of a brightness on the right side. Go down a little bit here. See the trees in the middle ground. See the differences in all the colors? That's what makes that look very real. It's not too boring. Other set of trees. Come down to the cabin. Walk across here. This down one more. So you see that looks like there's a lot of light hitting back there in the background. And that's sort of the effect I was trying to get. Okay. All right, folks, thanks for sticking with me. I'm sorry I had audio problems at the beginning of this video. I don't know what caused that, but anyway, we're finished now. Till next month, third Wednesday of May, we'll have another painting, and I hope you can tune in. It'll be live. And I hope I won't have the audio problems. And so look for this video to be posted on YouTube in about 2 or 3 days. And until I see you again, that's Larry Hampton saying so long for now.